Les objectifs du développement durable doivent être atteints.
Sustainable development goals must be attained by all UN member states by 2030, which means that all countries are urged to jointly face urgent challenges for the planet. What does it mean, all countries? It means each of us, together. We must strive to put in place a kind of planet citizenship. And in order to build this citizenship, the states must mobilize their populations, all of them, those that are already engaged in the process. They must also support, translate into facts, multilateral initiatives, and urge forward the weakest among us. This globalization will no longer be seen as a loss of identity and resources, but rather like a new occasion to shape new kinds of solidarity. Actually, the issue of the Anthropocene, of the fight against global warming, certainly our only universal agendas. Environmental citizenship was implemented in these last few years by regaining ownership of public spaces, namely natural spaces which had been viewed precisely as something citizens could not gain ownership of. Sustainable development goals allowed to elaborate a universal agenda, a kind of new encyclopedia, very much like the one created in the 18th century. We now have to mobilize all the stakeholders towards the global objective of social prosperity, a concept coined to replace that of progress, replacing it in as far as it shows that there is a dark side to progress. The challenge consists in including all kinds of protection, not only that of the most vulnerable populations, but also protection of the biosphere. In other words, citizenship built through sustainable development goals is the individual and collective meaning of the global agenda. There are, let's put it that way, two main issues. The first main issue with the matching SDGs is about preserving the rule of law, indissoluble from a new age of globalization. Let us remember how important the question of migration has become in Europe, in Western countries, reminding us of all the mistakes, the shortcomings of globalization. People forced to migrate, not something they had chosen to do, when facing brutal and trauma-inducing separations between the fates of workers, producers, consumers, and citizens. We are quite simply reaching the end of the system, which consists in transferring to others the fact that no one had thought of a social justice model. The earth is round, it is not infinite, and the problem bounces back in the face of those who made it happen. Thus, our rule of law could well be destroyed from the inside and from the outside precisely because it does not address the social issue, which is indissoluble from the migration issues, nowadays indissoluble from the environmental issue. What kind of social justice model do we want to put in place in the countries which would be compatible with a globalization process which automatically makes us think of a new regulatory age? Consider the state of the art. Economists, anthropologists, legal specialists, they all acknowledge the dialectic of vulnerabilities, or conversely, that of capacities, negative loop feedback, as they call it, where democratic governance is inadequate, where resources are exploited in a dangerous way, reinforcing economic and social vulnerabilities. It is absolutely vital if we wish to preserve the idea of and achieve a rule of law, of rules of law, that we do not disconnect these issues from those pertaining to social justice, the environment, and global governance. Environmental justice, environmental ethics, environmental burden, environmental debt. These are terms often heard and which explain accurately today how the social justice model is indissoluble from regulated thought, a thought on the way we view a more harmonious relationship, a less voracious relationship with nature, with natural resources. The work by Elinor Ostrom, Éloi Laurent, Knothouse, Tobin Gadret, Richardson, Jared Diamond, Descola, of course, Michel Prieur, we can't name them all, remind us that the foundation for the social contract is nature itself. Nature is the first pillar in the social contract, and pitching the social contract against the natural contract would make little sense. We live thanks to ecosystemic services, i.e. services rendered by nature to man. In the future, we're going to have to invent new modes of governance, sovereignty combinations. What is that? I would call it quite simply rematerializing global governance, meaning we will go towards the age of globalization, which does not bring more technocracy, but rather re-territorializes globalization, relocates globalization. We're not going back to times long gone, but we must absolutely think of social and environmental justice models better adapted to the territories, and yet, and that's what's difficult, keep talking uninterruptedly with the issue of global governance. These are the sovereignty combinations and the lines between, on the one side, the national rule of law, and on the other side, the world governance. And of course, there will be the need to invent models of solidarity, which in a way are a new version of economy. There's the matter of corporate social responsibility, the emergence of companies with a mission to fulfill, the matter of an economy creating not negative externalities but positive ones. Finally, there's the matter of common good, what cannot be owned versus ownership. We built our societies, quite rightly so, on the concept of ownership. We will need to build the 21st century also on the preservation of common goods, of large common goods, and around the idea that nature cannot be owned. That's the first main point. The second main point is the issue of health for man and societies. We need to put in place a much more extensive definition for WHO. You're all familiar with the definition of health according to WHO. It's not the mere absence of disease, but rather a complete state of physical, mental, economic and social well-being. And one might add, environmental. We see, therefore, that man preserves his greater health, as Nietzsche would put it, when he can feel he is part of the biosphere, in harmony with the surrounding nature. It is the question of biophilia. We must remember that we have inside us a microbiome, quite simply a bacterial genome in constant dialogue with the environment, and our health results from a happy interaction between our body and its environment. We also have very important work carried out by conservation psychologists such as Anne-Caroline Prévost, Kellert, Peter Kane, Clayton, all these people who remind us that we must pay attention to what is referred to as environmental amnesia, i.e. this progressive extinction of the experience of nature. Now, that constitutes a problem because it induces a dangerous relationship between man and nature, dangerous for man. One last thing before I conclude. I'd like to remind you of how paradoxical the digital transition is, which is indissoluble, again, from the ecological transition. It allows us to accomplish huge progress with regard to our sustainable development goals, I'll grant you that, notably with regard to citizen enablement, as they call it, giving them the capacity. But also remember that digital transition has its dark side, the energy-consuming one. Suffice to think about data centers and also rare metals or minerals, earths, from which most of our connected objects are made. Rare metals are extracted, refined. These processes are extremely polluting ones. In the future, we will need to raise, but also dismantle, the question of the energy and digital transition in the wake of the ecological transition. One very last point to conclude. In fact, we must go back to the very beginning of history to remember which is the truth, the original meaning of economy. Economy comes from oikos, nomos in Greek. Or more simply, oikos, the household, serving the household, serving the way we inhabit the planet. The world is not immediately hospitable, habitable by man. What is habitable is a world built by man, built by solidarities, built by care, namely care for nature. Tomorrow, we will need to understand that we are striving to put in place a kind of economy that will not only be hospitable for man, but will also be capable of welcoming man's humanism.
L'humanisme des hommes.